But thank you very much for coming. Really appreciate it. And that's what I would start with, is if there was any questions that you came kind of burning that you want to make sure I talk about, or if there's an example of a skill you'd like me to include in the examples tonight that's unique to your experience, and I can make note and try to pull that back up when I do examples.
I'm sure they go out of the way.
Did anybody come with a burning question or a skill that they're looking for some strategies on how to teach specifically? Bed making, teeth brushing, rural geography.
Okay. Teeth brushing wouldn't be bad. It's a fight. Teeth brushing is a fight.
Teeth brushing, okay. That's a one I can easily incorporate.
Not taking off. He sees a dog.
Oh my goodness.
I think I looked at her and I started laughing. Not taking off every time he sees a dog.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
That's a little bit different than
the No, I know. That was more for her benefit than anything. I'm sorry. Couldn't resist. Okay.
So this is going to be really informal and casual. So if you think of questions or examples, something that you want me to speak more on, please interrupt me and get my attention, because it's going to be hopefully really back and forth between both of us. Okay. So I titled it Task Analyses, Prompts, and Shaping. Those are the three big tools in a behavior analyst or an educator's toolbox when teaching a new skill. So I'll just kind of wave my hand like this if you want to go to the next one. So what some people may not appreciate is behavior analysts are really well prepared to teach new skills as much as we are to manage problem behavior. A lot of times people don't call a behavior analyst until they have a severe problem behavior, they need a behavior plan. We don't often get called by school or family just to help with a teaching of a new skill, unless you're talking about EIBI or that early intensive behavior intervention. But our flagship journal, the Journal of Applied Behavior Analysis, has majority of our research is in the acquisition of new target skills, actually. And if you think about it, that makes sense, because if we're the experts in managing problem behavior and reducing bad behavior, what did we learn from our earlier workshops is the most important part of that behavior plan is what are we going to teach the student to do instead of the problem behavior. So there is that teaching element just in the behavior plan for reduction. Thank you. So I'm not going to talk tonight specific about discrete trial teaching because that wouldn't be applicable to everyone here. But I just wanted to just have a slide or two about telling you what it is, because it is a technology that we use to teach. And it's not unique to autism, it's not unique to children. It's just really good teaching, actually. So DTT is discrete trial teaching. It's a way that you can apply the principles of behavior. It's not the same as ABA. And what the expression discrete trial teaching refers to, that discrete part, meaning that there's a clear beginning and a clear end to a trial. So a discrete trial begins with a SD or the demand, you know, do this, give me that, touch this, and it ends with the feedback, either reinforcement for a correct response or feedback, and then you start over again. So there's a demand, there's the prompt, there's the response, and then there's either the reinforcement or the corrective feedback. So that's what discrete trial is. And I put five elements of what kind of are in every discrete trial. So if you're working with a child to teach a new skill and you're using discrete trial teaching, you're breaking skills into small, manageable, teachable parts, teachable components, right? You're giving that student lots of repeated practice. That's a key piece of discrete trial, is they're learning quicker because they're getting lots of opportunities to practice. And I didn't put errorless learning up here because that's not kind of inherent in discrete trial teaching, but it's a really smart way to do it because it doesn't allow a student to make repeated errors. That's actually testing, right? So the difference between teaching and testing, and a lot of people don't understand this part of it, is if I just keep asking a kid a question and they just keep getting it wrong, I'm just testing them. Oh, still don't know it. Oh, still don't know it. Oh, still don't know it. So the prompting is your teaching technology, and that's what differentiates a testing trial versus a teaching trial, is the prompt. So discrete trial, you use prompts, and then you systematically get rid of those prompts or fade your prompts, which is what we're going to talk about a lot more tonight. And then you have the element of reinforcement. So that's about as much as I'm going to talk about in discrete trial tonight, but I just thought that was important to mention. And in the survey at the end, if you're interested in spending an hour and a half coming back and just talking about discrete trial, I could definitely fill an hour and a half on a discrete trial. Let's go on then to reinforcement. So reinforcement should be a review topic for everyone, because we talk about it, I think, in every night that I've come down a workshop. But it would be negligent of me not to include it tonight early on what differentiates smart teaching from poor teaching is the use of reinforcement. So there was a quote in one of my books that didn't have an author to it, but it said, if you do not have good reinforcers and are not working to establish them, you might as well go home. So the first thing, if someone calls me and says, hey, you know, this kid's not making progress, right? Then the first thing I'm going to figure out, or I'm going to kind of rule out, is reinforcement. Do you have a powerful reinforcer? Because more often than not, that first question is going to, the answer is going to be, I don't test stuff because I don't. And then you do a prep assessment, you identify something that they're really motivated by, and all of a sudden the learning takes off. So like I said, the first thing, if you're having a problem with a kiddo or a student making progress on a skill, stop and say, I wonder if they're not well motivated. That often explains a lot. Reinforcement when you're teaching needs to be faded. So you start with heavy, rich reinforcement, and we've talked about when you're teaching a brand new skill, reinforcement looks like pretty much all the time, right? So you don't have this skill yet, so every time you display it, I'm going to make a big deal about it, every single time. But then when you want a behavior to stick around for a long time, you don't continue to reinforce it every single time. You fade that to an intermittent schedule, which means once in a while, on an unpredictable schedule, I'll reinforce you, and it just keeps the behavior happening over a long period of time. So that's sound familiar? And then this plan to fade to natural motivators. So sometimes we get criticized for using tangibles or food or videos because they should be intrinsically motivated. They should want to work for the sake of work. But really, none of us work for the sake of work, right? We get reinforced by tokens, right? So this dollar bill is exchangeable for goods and services. Right? It's meaningless without the exchange value, right? It's just a piece of paper. Similarly to students that we work with, they get a token oftentimes, which they can exchange for what we call a backup reinforcer, and that's how it has value. So that's what we say to the concern about intrinsic motivation. It's really none of us are working for this. It feels so great. Okay, so a couple more notes about reinforcement. Remember the definition of reinforcement is that you're adding something after a behavior to make the behavior more likely to happen next time. That's all that word means. So for your student, your child, how do you identify what the reinforcers are you should use to teach them to brush their teeth or to teach them independence with following, say, a morning routine? Or identifying complex numbers, or trying to think of this person's name. So what you would do, there's several ways. One is just observe. What in a free play situation does that person tend to do with their free time? You know, do they gravitate towards ball play? Do they hang out with their stuffed animals? Do they listen to music? Are they on YouTube? So just by just paying attention, you can get some pretty good ideas for reinforcement. Other ways is by connecting more formal or informal assessments. So there's paired choice where I offer, hey, you want this one or this one? You know, we'll do that sometimes with foods with some of our students here. And whatever one they reach for, oh, that's the one you want. That's called just paired choice. Sounds fancy, paired choice, but it's really just which one of these two things do you want. And whether they point to it, touch it, label it with their words, that's your paired choice. There's assessments where you have replacement or without replacement. So I put an array of things out. I mean, I put out a cell phone, a bag of chips, I don't know, a yo-yo, Slinky, whatever. And whatever one they pick, I take that out of the array. So that's their first choice. Now the array has three things left in it. Whatever they select, that's their second choice. Because if I kept putting, say, the iPad in the array, they just keep going back to the iPad, and I want to get to learn kind of hierarchy of their preferences. Okay? And then there's a single stimulus assessment where you just put an item out, and if the student engages with it, makes contact with it within so many seconds, okay, that might be a preference. And that would be for maybe a more limited learner who isn't so good at making choices. You just are measuring it by eye contact or physical contact with the eye. And the last one is questions. Questions of caregivers, people who know the student well, or asking the student directly, hey, what are you excited about? You want them to say, well, I love to go and play basketball. That's what I care about. Or, can you just leave me alone? Oh, hey, we can work for that. Get three right and I'm out of here, you know? So asking the student themselves or the caregiver. Those are some ways that you can identify reinforcers. The next slide is about how can you develop a reinforcer, because many of the students that I serve, they're challenging in that they don't come to me with a long list of things that I'm really motivated by. Because if they did, learning would be easy and quick, because, wow, if I just tell them they'll get this really cool thing, they'll just jump through all these hoops to get it. So what we often find is students who have a limited list of things that they're motivated by, or their things that they're motivated by change often, right? So change quickly, they satiate on them, so that, God, they were crazy about boring. And then sure enough, they couldn't care less about boring. Oh, scram, what am I going to do now? And what I say is, really, don't start teaching or placing demands until you identify that reinforcer. Otherwise, you're just kind of, you know, shooting yourself in the foot, because they're not going. Most students we know don't work for free, right? They want to be reinforced. So here are some strategies to develop a reinforcer. First thing is deprivation. So we know most of our students, they do care about, you know, maybe it's TV, maybe it's basketball, maybe it's free time, maybe it's in your certain magazines that would have, you know, whether it's things that they'd like to buy at the store or some magazines about anime or whatever. There are these things that they really enjoy, but they're kind of giving it for free most of the time. You know, this is how they get home from school. There's here's all that cool stuff just available for free. So now it's, you know, dinner time, and it's like, okay, it's time to get that homework. Let's knock out this math worksheet, and then you can have more time with anime video or whatever it is. iPad, like, man. Nah. You know, I just had it for free for an hour and a half. I'm kind of done with it. Thanks though, right? And then you're so you got your reinforcer that you selected, that you had in mind, is very low value because your student just had it for free. So depriving them of the things that you want them to work for to get makes that value much higher. And so that's something to consider. Because a lot of kiddos get really cool stuff for free. And then when they want to work for it, they're not motivated. And they also will know that they wait long enough to get it for free again. So it can really be a really smart thing to do is to deprive them of those things that you want them to work for. Free sample. You think about, you know, cable companies are really good about this, right? Or the fancy radio in your car, XM radio or Sirius radio. Like, you know, here, just have it for free for a month. You know, you would never think you needed, you know, Showtime and whatever, or a Sirius radio, because you never had any experience with it. And then they give it to you for free, and I'm like, I can't without this. $25.99 a month? Sign me up, right? But you would have never spent $25 a month for this because you had never had experience with it. So you wouldn't have paid your money for it or worked for it, so to speak. So same idea with a free sample. There's things that your student might be really motivated to work on, they just haven't had experience with it. Or they haven't had seen it be as fun as it can be when you engage with them with it. Or, you know, maybe you keep showing them this truck or this, you know, I'm trying to think of examples from high school age students too. But say you put out a truck, now, God, this is never interested in my trucks, but has he ever seen it go, you know, through a wheelie, backwards, through a, you know, whatever? Maybe not, because he hasn't seen how cool it could be until you've engaged with it or something certainly. So free samples are cool. And then pairing, so let's say, what's a great example? Okay, baseball. So I'm not a huge sports fan. But if every time I go on a date to a baseball game, I get a whole bunch of good snacks, right? And I get the drinks and whatever. And so my experiences with this kind of non-preferred or neutral sports game are paired with all the things that I find really valuable and reinforcing. Every next time someone invites me to go to a baseball game, I'd be like, yeah, because I'm thinking, oh, that good stuff, I'm going to go with it. And so that's the same idea, is you pair something that you know is already valuable with something kind of neutral or less valuable, and then that less valuable thing all of a sudden starts getting more valuable. And then And that's the concept that we use when we pair social praise with tangibles. So kids don't often find our, hey, you're amazing, oh my gosh, you're way to go, you know, and all that stuff, all that reinforcing sometimes. They're like, I don't know what you're doing. Just give me the cars to line up or whatever. And every time I deliver the cars, they're going to line up with the social praise. My social praise can become more valuable because of the history being paired with the good stuff. Because we always care about thinning reinforcement and getting to more natural reinforcement, which looks like less often, less intense, and more social. So questions so far? I covered the topics of reinforcement, identifying reinforcement. Is that okay? All right, I'm going to keep going then. So what about praise? So I just talked about always pairing praise with a tangible. Thinning your tangibles. Tangible just means something that you can feel, or touch, or see. And be specific about what you're praising. Now this one is interesting because, you know, earlier in my career, we were so careful about this. This was kind of the mantra. You know, I love how you're sitting in that chair upright. You know, thank you so much for handing me that paper. And it just kind of felt kind of unnatural or somewhat robotic and not the way people kind of spoke all the time. So I think we're getting better about, yeah, we want to label what it is that you like, but in a way that kind of sounds normal and real. Just kind of a caveat there because I've been around long enough that I've seen that kind of change where we're trying to be more natural sounding. But you do want to be careful that you are labeling what it is that you're praising for those learners where they might get confused. Where, you know, if they just gave you the right card that you would ask for, and then they sneeze, and you're like, hey, good job!
Yeah.
And they think that maybe that's the sneeze, and you're going to see more sneezing because that was, or to me, not the social phrase, but you deliver the food after the sneeze, they think it's the sneeze that got the food and not the correct response. So that's kind of the rationale behind being specific. The good job, this is just a note to every staff here. Everyone is guilty of overusing good job. So really try to mix up your praise statements because good job doesn't sound very reinforcing after you've heard it 20 times. It sounds really boring and really uninteresting and you don't want to work for it anymore. So I would also look at voice differential because we work with a wide range of ages. Sometimes what we'll do is we'll kind of sound all the same. So especially for early learners can be really impactful because they're not even paying attention to they don't understand all that language, but they're getting so much information from your tone, your inflection, your facial expression. And so if it all sounds the same, they can't tell the difference. So we try to make our demand sound more flat and neutral, and then our praise sound different. So even if they're not getting all that words, all that language that they're hearing, they can get much more information if we change the tone and the volume, the expression from the demand from the praise. All right. So now we're going to talk about task analysis. This is one of the three big tools in our toolbox, right? Prompt, rating, shaping, task analysis. So what task analysis means is you're just taking a pretty big skill and chunking it into really small parts, manageable parts. And teeth brushing is a great example of a skill that's appropriate for task analysis. So once you've taken your skill and bring it down into small parts, then there's three different ways you can teach it. But I want to talk a little bit longer about task analysis. So how you do a task analysis, the best way to do it is to actually do the skill yourself. You know, if you think about teeth brushing, if we all took 5 minutes and wrote down all the steps of teeth brushing, I'm certain that we would have very many different lists, right? Because someone might not remember saying, oh yeah, I hit the cap off this toothpaste, right? And I, at home, I wet my toothbrush first, which has a thing about, yeah, I don't need to do that. And maybe many of you are better with the environment, so you're not running out of water and getting your toothbrush wet first. So me doing all the steps would be important before I teach it. And me doing the action myself. So that's how you really do the test. You just write all those steps down after doing the steps yourself. And you'd be surprised how many there could be. Like if we just say toothbrushing, because a lot of our kids at all ages could use help with independent toothbrushing. So like I said, so maybe it is taking the cap off of toothpaste, then it's squeezing the right amount, that's a big one, of toothpaste on the brush. Then you have to apply the brush to your teeth, and you have to move it around, all the different stuff, down, back, front. Okay, then you have to rinse the toothbrush. Maybe you put some water in your mouth and swish it around, and you have to spit that out. That's probably was already 9. And then you just keep, and you have to put the toothpaste lid back on. So you get the idea. Okay. So other skills that lend themselves well to task analyses besides teeth brushing, can we have a kind of shout out? What's a few other skills that might have lots of steps? Hand washing.
Getting dressed.
Putting your shoes on. Shoe tying is a really good one.
Showering.
Yeah. Taking a shower. Yeah, all those steps and shampooing and the soaping and the rinsing and yeah. I think like making a bed, you know, changing a tire, things that adults do, making a sandwich. All those. Okay. So that's some examples there. So now I'm going to tell you about those three different ways of teaching a skill using forward chaining, backward chaining, and total task presentation. So forward chaining, what this means is that you gain independence with the very beginning steps of that sequence first. Okay? So let's take the example of teeth brushing. I would fade my prompts from taking the cap off the toothpaste first, and then I would prompt every other step in toothbrushing. And I would get the student to independently take that cap off the toothpaste, and then I would go to the second step, and then maybe it's wetting the brush. And I did that independent. And I would prompt all the other steps in the task analysis. That's forward chaining. I fade my prompts at the forward or the front part of all that chain first, okay? An advantage of forward chaining is you get behavioral momentum. So you get the student responding independently, they're more likely to just keep on going, okay? I'm gonna show you a video now. My helper is terrific. Thank you, Jess Miller, for being such a good helper with this. She's really good with technology. Okay, so this is just 1 minute.
Slap your hand.
This lesson plan uses a forward chain to teach the student to wash hands. When using forward chain, the steps of the task are trained from the beginning of the sequence to the end.
Let's wash our hands.
When Cassidy is already able to complete some of the initial steps independently, a prompt is given for her to complete the target training step, turning off water. Reinforcement, in this case a token, must be provided immediately following the completion of the training step. For the remaining steps haven't been targeted yet, the teacher provides hand-over-hand prompts, helping the student to complete the entire task correctly.
Okay, so that's just an example of what that looks like. Do you have questions about that? Okay. So then we have, should have had backward chaining in there, that's good, okay. So when backward chaining, kind of same concept, right? So I'm going to teach the child to do the last step in the sequence first. And this actually makes a lot of sense to teach skills this way, because it's very motivating to feel like you just finished the activity alone. So whether it's shoe tying, and the last thing they do is pull that the two bows apart, look, you tie your shoes, that's really reinforcing. Or to make a bed, and the last thing you do is throw that pillow on top. You feel like you just made the bed, even though all you did by yourself was throw that pillow on. So that's one reason to pick backward chaining.
Would you do everything else prior, and then
you would help them with all the other steps? And then help doesn't have to be the full hand over hand like we saw in hand washing. It could be verbal instruction, where you're verbally reminding them of each step, and then at the end you're like, and they put the pillow on. Like, all right. And then once they've learned to get that pillow on, then now you're gonna help them do everything except for the last two things, which might be both pillows or pulling that last blanket up and then the pillow. And then, all right, and then you get that consistent, and then you go to the third to last step. And that's where you drop your help. Here's dropping the help from the end of the steps. Okay? So I've taught kids to learn their phone number with backward chaining. Where you provide all 7 digits, right? And the first step is, what's your phone number? And this is a student who can read numbers, right? They read all 7 digits. That right, that is your phone number. That's phase 1. So you get them to learn that, what's your phone number? In the presence of a full textual cue, they can read all 7 digits. And then you drop off that last number. What's your phone number? They're reading, again, so that doesn't be hand over hand. Here's your full textual cue, each number, and then the last one is blank. And then they fill it in. And you get that mastered, consistently independent. you drop off those last two digits of the number. You can do the same exact skill you did before with training, right? So what's your phone number? You provide all seven, and then after that's learned, you would take the first number off of the cue card, and they would remember that number, get that learned, get the second number, get that learned. So that's one of the things I've used with the backward training, really successfully. I've been surprised how quick kids are learning their phone numbers with this strategy. And other skills. So if you think about how we typically teach skills as parents and people, it usually looks like total task chaining, where I want to teach a kid to, change a mirror, mm-hmm. teach a nephew or something to change a tire. Well, you're probably just going to prompt them through every single step. And as you see, they kind of got it on their own. You might just back off, but it's kind of a total task. There's no real system to it. You just kind of take it, okay, I got to teach them this big skill. Maybe it's my phone number, maybe it's the bed making, whatever. And I'm just going to help them everywhere they need help through the whole thing. That's kind of how we typically would teach, not doing this backward forward chaining business. Okay, so with backward chaining, that is where, I've already said, you're dropping the cues from the end of the response. And it allows the learner to continuously observe the correct performance of the task. That's helpful, right? So with that phone number business, they're getting lots of practice seeing the right answer of every single digit in that number. And you get lots of reinforcement in the beginning stages of teaching. And we talked about this. Finishing the task is the greatest reward in life, a natural reward. I think I've got a video here as well, a little bit longer than the first one, but still really brief, to show what this looks like.
How to perform backward chaining. The definition of backward chaining is linking together behaviors beginning with the last behavior in the chain. Let's go through the procedure with the same example of washing hands in order to see how this type of chaining differs from forward chaining. First, prompt your student to perform all the behaviors in the chain in order, except for the last behavior, and then reinforce your student's independent performance of the last behavior.
Wash hands. Okay, we're gonna turn water on. Get soap. Rub hands, scrub, 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 rub, rub, rub. Excellent, water off. Great job, your hands are all clean now. Here, use your free treat.
In this example, we see the instructor prompting the student to turn on water. Get soap. Rub hands. Rinse hands. And turn off water. The instructor stops before the last behavior, and the student must complete the last behavior of drying hands independently in order to receive reinforcement. Then, reinforce your student's independent performance of the next to last and last behaviors in order.
Wash hands. You're gonna turn water on. Get soap. Rub your hands, rub, 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 scrub, scrub, scrub. Great job, you remember it all by yourself. That's excellent. Here's your free treat.
Now, you see the instructor prompts the student to turn on water, get soap, rub hands, and rinse hands, but then stops, so that the student must complete the last two behaviors of turning off water and drying hands in order to get the reinforcer. Then reinforce your student's independent performance of the last three steps in order and continue in this manner until your student can complete the entire chain independently following the SD. An advantage of using backward chaining is that the reinforcement always falls at the end of the chain, allowing you to use a variety of reinforcers.
Any questions about that? Okay. Now we're going to go into our second topic, which is prompting. So prompting is, again, what we said differentiates between testing and teaching. If you're not prompting, you really aren't teaching, and that's true across both program areas. So prompts are used to increase the likelihood that a student will provide a desired response. And the timing of the prompt is really important. The timing of the prompt needs to be with the SD, and SD means the demand or discriminative stimulus. So if I say, come here, or I say, give me that, or I say, you know, do this action, whatever it is, that's the SD. Okay, when I say SD, discriminative stimulus, it's just your demand for our purposes today. So the prompt needs to come with the demand. That'll be that 0 second delay. So I say, you know, for example, I beg, you know, give me this, right? I didn't give her a chance to not do this. She is not going to get that answer wrong, right? I helped her as I was asking her what to do. So then I just made sure I got that answer right. That's 0 second prompt delay. Prompt came with the instruction. But the best prompts come before the response, right? So that's the whole definition of a prompt. It's something that you put in place to help the response, get the response that you want. So there's two big types of prompts. There's response prompts and there's stimulus prompts. And we're going to talk about both. So a response prompt are all the ones that you kind of think of. And that was, I think, you were asked on your pretest. Name 5 response prompts. So why don't we do a shout out? What are some response prompts?
Hand over hand.
Hand over hand. Yeah, big common one. Hand over hand. Partial physical. So you both named the physical ones, right? So hand over hand or partial physical.
A verbal
prompt.
Mm-hmm.
Partial verbal, yeah. And then there's a model prompt, right? Or a gesture prompt. And then visual and text. Right. So those are all response prompts. So I'm going to prompt your behavior, is really what that is. I'm prompting your behavior. That's how it's different from the stimulus prompts. Okay. And when you hear people talk about prompts, you'll often hear them talk about least to most to least, prompting hierarchy. And I've never bought into that because this is depending on the student, what is the most intrusive prompt, and the skill is going to vary on what is the most intrusive prompt. There's not a hard and fast, this is the most intrusive prompt, although usually it would be the hand over hand, full physical. And this is least intrusive because a lot of times you say, well, what's the least intrusive prompt? They might say, well, it's just a verbal. It's just a verbal cue. You know, that's really not intrusive. But that's rarely the right answer for the least intrusive prompt because it's very hard to get rid of. People become quite dependent on those verbal cues. So really one of the least intrusive prompts probably is a little gesture. You know? If I get you to do whatever I want by just kind of doing this, that's a pretty good prompt, right? I don't have to do it myself. I have to model it first. I don't have to repeat myself. I don't have to explain it. I don't have to draw a picture of it or write it out. This and you'll know what I mean. You know, like Ricky.
You know.
So there you go. Here I listed out, so I kind of prompt them as visual prompts. So these are all the ways you can cue a behavior that you want using a visual prompt. Whether it's a model, a gesture, a text, or a picture. So maybe we should stop because I think I'm maybe ahead of schedule. And let's all share what some of these skills or examples of visual prompts. So if the skill you're working on, maybe you need one from the high school program or from the academic program. What's the skill that you're teaching the kiddo? Or you know, calm kiddos, calm students.
Yeah, so just more of a categories you mean?
I guess just a general skill that you'd be prompting.
So raising their hand.
Raising hand. All right, that's what that is. Raising hand before they shout out the answer or ask something. Okay.
Right.
So raising their hand. So you could probably use any of these four strategies to teach that skill. So if you asked a question, and right before there was a delay, so before someone could blurt out the answer, so the question is like, you know, what's the capital of Missouri? And as you're answering the question, you've already provided this model cue, right? You didn't ask a question and then wait for someone to blurt out the answer, and then, right? So you could model the right response as you're giving the question. You could, you know, what's the capital of Missouri? You know, this is a little more awkward to try and gesture you what you want. And then the text might look like, you know, raise your hand, you know, that you would just kind of gesture towards this text cue that says what they need to do before. So what's the capital of Missouri? And maybe you're gesturing towards the reminder of raise hand before someone blurts out the answer. And then you can fade that. And what's interesting about these textual cues and visual cues that are pictures or text is kids remember, oh yeah, and all of a sudden you're just like putting up a blank hand or a blank sheet of paper and there's no cueing on it, but the actual presence of that card, even though it's blank, triggers their oh yeah, I remember I need to raise my hand, even though there's no words on it. So that's kind of cool. Because you can take that raised hand that you've written on your index card or written on your hand with a Sharpie, and all of a sudden you just start washing your hand, it gets faded and more faint. Where at first they needed to be spelled out, raised hand and black Sharpie, but then as you wash your hands, however, it's still working, even though they can't even hardly read it across the room, they just remember it had said raised hand on there. And all of a sudden, that little gesture again, we're talking about gestures, now you've kind of gestured, your hand's got nothing on it, but they remember, oh yeah, this meant I gotta remember to do this. So that's kind of neat. And the picture, of course, could be a picture of someone raising their hand. So those are some examples of visual prompts. And I just talked to you about how you can fade within a prompt. So you can fade across prompt types and within a prompt. So example, with the visual or the text of raised hand, I showed you how you can fade that within that type of prompt. So a full textual, black Sharpie, wash your hand, if it's faded, faded. That's fading within a prompt type. Similarly with a model, you know, maybe I have to do this full thing, and later I can kind of do this. I can fade, and I can also fade prompts across prompt types, where you have to start with maybe the full text cue, and then you can fade to just like a gesture or something. So there's two different ways you can fade both across type and within a prompt. In the next slide, I'm going to talk about a few more response prompts, which are those verbal ones. And you guys are quick at naming these as, you know, I'm going to tell you exactly what I want you to do. You know, raise your hand, that's that full verbal cue. And if I say that before they've engaged in the wrong answer, then that was a successful prompt. And then I can fade it to ray. Oh, okay, I'm going to say raise hand. I say ray. Okay, yeah, I'm going to fail. So that's an example of a partial verbal prompt. We use them quite a bit with younger learners who are trying to learn, say their parents' name, or their street address, or their phone number, or the name of a common object, or shape, or color, because you might put up the picture. I say that we're doing introverbal, so there's nothing we're using to the answer, just talking, and I'm like, what's your mom's name, Brenda? Oh, yes, Brenda, right? That would be a partial verbal. I don't have to tell them Brenda, I just go, oh, yeah, Brenda, or I can do the, and that's enough. So you can really fade those verbals down. It's really important that you do, because talked about, this is one of the stickiest ones to get rid of because people get real dependent on that. All right. I also wanted to make one more note on that one about the verbal cues is you can also think of verbal cues as a within stimulus prompt, but kind of can be both. If I'm trying to get you to talk louder, can I say, talk louder, right? The hint on how I wanted her to respond was built into my SE. So, that wasn't a verbal prompt as a response prompt, it was actually was built into my demand, which is what's called the stimulus prompt. Yeah, we all do everything like, right? So I just cued them what I meant by the way that I delivered the demand. Okay, so now we're talking about the second type of prompt, which is the stimulus prompt. And these are really cool, and they're not used very often because they take some prep time. A lot often they take, some don't, but some do. The coolest ones take prep time. And they're more advantageous than the response prompts because the learner gets cued on what the right response is without requiring some other adult or other person in the environment to tell them what the right answer is. I'm gonna go over several examples and we'll spend some time with this. So a stimulus prompt, any type of prompt in which we change the materials in a way to help the learner give the correct response. So the change is in the materials, or in my example, within the demand. And anytime we change the way the materials look, how we put them on the table, or anything about them, if we change anything that to help get the right answer, that's a stimulus prompt. Okay, so I brought some examples. On the video, I guess I'll hold them up. So, we do receptive tasks sometimes in the language program, where we talk about task analysis. We're trying to teach a student, say, to identify a car from an airplane, right? They don't know common object labels. They're not going around labeling common objects. We would start, say, maybe with matching identical pictures to identical pictures. Then we would go to matching non-identical pictures. Then we would go to receptive identification. Then we go to that label now. Okay, now this is an airplane, right? So this is an example where we're doing receptive identification. Again, I kind of need maybe some tape for the walls or tape in here.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, I can maybe just hold them up. So we've got green, red, and blue. Okay? I'm sorry, it's hard for you to see over there. Thank you, Al. So here's my field. I'm teaching a student to receptively identify words, the reading, right? He's an early reader. And I want him to learn to read the word blue. So I have made the word blue look different than the wrong answer. Even if he has no idea how to spell the word blue or how to identify the word blue, if I say, which one is blue? Again, I'm going to put this up kind of like this, right? They're more likely to respond to this one because it's just bolder. So if I was really smart, what I would do is have a set of materials set up in advance where the kid would learn to identify blue when it's this bold. And then I would have another, and I didn't do this, but I'd have another blue that was still bolder than these two, but less so than this one. That would be my phase two. And then I would probably be ready to have it look just exact same boldness as the two wrong answers. Okay, that's within stimulus cue. I put some hints in my material to respond towards this one. Even though they don't know the right answer, that's how they're getting it right. Okay, so that's an example. Another example of within stimulus cue would be if this was the right answer. Which one is blue, right? And then you start fading out and making it look more and more black. So that's another example within stimulus cue. Another example within stimulus cue, and I didn't do it right, let's see. If we pretend that this is blue, just in the exact same font and thickness as the other two answers, and I put it like this, and my student is sitting here, right? And I say, which one's blue? I just positioned it closer to the learner, so they're more likely to respond to it, because the wrong answers are farther away. And I get that shaped up, and then I start moving the right answer more and more into the array. That's another within stimulus cue, okay? Just a small note is I kind of came up learning to put my materials out or my stimuli out in an array that looked just like this, and it was just like this. Because you didn't want to accidentally give it away. Right. This looked right, and just by being sloppy, but now kids start to respond to the right answer, and I'm thinking, oh, they're learning, and it's because I kind of had it kind of more close to the learner, and they were looking for all these. They care about the reward, so they wanted to get it right. They had no idea what the right answer was, but they put this clue, a little skew than the rest, I'm going to go with that. But in real life, in a natural array of, hey, go get me a soda, or no, bring me that book, stimuli aren't in these perfect arrays all the time in life. So you have to be able to identify things in messy natural arrays. So now we tend to try to put things in messy natural arrays. We put things on a table. And so sometimes the right answer might be way up here, but next time I ask you, it's going to be back here. And if you're still responding to blue, no matter where I have it in the field, I'm going to know you pretty much know blue. So these are some examples of within stimulus cues here. So I showed you positional. I showed you within stimulus. Other examples would be if you're teaching letters and the U looks like an umbrella. You can make letters look like objects and animals and stuff, and that can cue a learner on what the right answer is without it requiring another person to point or gesture or physical guidance. So, let's see. I said size. Okay, so size would be another one, right? So if the card that was the head blue on it, I just cut these other cards smaller. Again, that would cue the learner to what the right answer was. The position, the shape, the color, the loudness or the intensity. Trying to think of an example where we use loudness or intensity in the classroom as a cue.
Maybe asking, like, is this big or small?
Yeah.
That type of thing.
Yeah.
Giving them
a
choice.
That's a good one. So the way you ask the question cues the answer, because you're kind of stressing the right answer within the question.
Right.
That's a good thing. Questions about prompts? I kind of jumped over all the different types. We have a stand over hand, so full physical, partial physical, model, gestures, text, where you just write it out, pictures, positional cueing. So I think with positional cue, not only with what red, blue, and green, but if I'm working with a student to follow directions to stand up or sit down, and I position the chair near him, and I'm like, hey, I want you to sit down, and the chair is right by him, and he has no idea what I said. But the presence of the chair cues the response to sit. I could have said, okay, I really like chocolate milk.
Yeah.
And they're like, okay, and they sit down because the presence of the chair. And they don't know what I said or what I said. So that's another example of, say, a positional prompt. And what we have, I know I have a slide about this, is all these inadvertent cues where we give students or our children credit for skills that we think that they have, maybe we've taught them, and we haven't done due diligence to make sure that we weren't providing any cueing at all. So that sit down is a great example. I always give staff the example. If I look at you in the eye and I say, I want you to sit down, I'm not gesturing toward a chair, I'm not looking at a chair, I'm not near a chair. You have to know exactly what I just said in order to do what I just said, right? I'm giving you no other hints, right? So what we do all the time is I want you to sit down. You didn't realize you just did this with your hands. That's how you talk. Well, you sit down, okay? And they do it, and oh my God, I just totally taught them to sit down. Well, you gotta fade this part, or else you're giving them too much credit. So if your hands are behind your back, and you're just looking them in the eyes, they want you to sit down, and they get up and hop over and sit in a chair, then you know it, right? So, sorry, remind me to stay in the video. So that's an example of an inadvertent cue, these gestures, you know. Another one is when we look at the right answer. So I want you to sit down. You know, I just glance at the chair because that's a natural way of talking. I was thinking about the chair, talking about the chair, I'm just going to glance at it. But if you don't know what I'm talking about, if you really want to please me or you want to get the reward, you're going to be really savvy at picking up all these inadvertent cues. That's how life works for you. So just looking at the right answer is tipping off someone to respond correctly oftentimes. And what we do in our discrete trial session, we put out our array of the right answers, right? So you're trying to get yourself together, you're busy, you got all this stuff to do, you're getting your materials out, you're getting ready to put your cards, and you're like, okay, look at your dish, okay, I have to target green, green's the next one I'm targeting. You put them out, and you look at green last, because that's the right answer, because we're getting ready to target, and the kids just paying attention where your eyes are going. So that glancing at the right answer is often something that we give away too. This isn't really a prompt per se, as when we think about it, but we have kids with biases who are always breaking whatever's in the middle of an array, or they have a left hand bias or a right hand bias, because whatever's over here I'm going to reach for. And a lot of times that can be the right answer. And if you're not good at mixing up your array or your materials, then you're going to be getting all those pluses, right answer, but they're just going whatever is with their bias, their positional bias. There's a teaching note there. Let's see. Then I want to talk about how all prompts need to be faded to prevent dependency. We've heard about those kind of bad stories where kids are prompt dependent, right? And I think of an example someone taught me about we can all relate to when you're teaching someone to drive and you are the driver is approaching a yellow light and the parent or the teacher in the passenger seat reaches over like this, right? And that's what's cueing the driver to slow down or to stop. It's not the presence of the yellow light or the red light. And so until they're doing it without someone going like this, they haven't actually learned the response. So when your behavior is controlled by the prompt and not the right stimulus. That's prompt dependency. All right. So as we talk about prompt fading, I'm going to tell you some ways in which you can fade your prompts. There's across three dimensions, across force and time and space. So we talked about a full physical prompt and a partial physical prompt. That's fading across force. So I'm going to first teach you by doing all the work for you, hand over hand, manual guidance. And then I'm going to fade it to just, we kind of use the expression elbow nudge, right? Now I get the same response, got to do this little elbow nudge that gets you going. That's across, a way to fade a prompt across force.
You know what else, Janice? Can I,
yeah, please.
When helping somebody form their letters correctly, if you do that, you just hold their right underneath the elbow, you start writing and making them smaller.
And get smaller?
It's
okay.
Just a...
That's cool. With handwriting, sometimes you can build in a prompt that doesn't require another person that might be similar to what you're describing, which is those three ring binders where you put the binder edge farther away and so there's that nice slant. And that type of wrist support can really help a learner with some handwriting that doesn't require, and any prompt that you can do that doesn't require a person is usually better, right? It's hard to get. It breeds independence faster. That's a good example, Laura. And then you can fade across time. And we talked about those 0 second prompt delays or that errorless learning where I'm going to provide the cue right with the instruction and not give you any chance to get the wrong answer. So I can also fade that type of prompt by giving you a few more seconds, gradually waiting until I come in with the cue. So I might teach a new response by immediately cueing or giving you the help right away. Get that. So you're never making a mistake, and then I'm now going to wait. I'm going to tell you what to do, I'm going to give you a second to get it right, and then I'm going to come up with the help. And I start gradually increasing the time that I wait to offer the support. And then across space. So that can be physically your proximity. You know, if you think about in a traditional school or traditional classroom, students have TAs or paraprofessional support, and people used to call them the shadows. Have you ever heard that? TA refers to the shadow. It's like, no! Like, the worst thing is for a TA is to serve in the role of a shadow. Because, at least for very long. Because you should be really working hard to distance yourself. Because shadows are horrible support that you would require. So, when I used to work with TAs all the time in a more traditional classroom setting, they'd be at the door. And the student that they were supporting was across the room. And they were just there in case they needed. They could do little gestures, they could do little reminders from where they were, and that's all the help they needed. And they would always worry about people thinking I'm not doing anything. You know, someone's gonna come by and think, you know, you're working for what? But that's really our goal is to fade that proximity or increase their proximity, so that the student's more and more independent. So that para who's getting that student to be on task and respond appropriately from across the room. That's, they should be delighted in themselves because that's what their objective was all along, was to fade the sense. Nobody should have a shadow for long.
That's like when you do when you go to action villain and stuff, I started fading proximity so that she doesn't need to be standing right next to her when we're doing tasks, so that's working really well with her. Or I'm just, you know, sitting across the room or paying attention to something else with my attention too.
Attention.
If I'm like slowly I'll actually be like, where I'm just reading or something, but just there.
If you got a little light.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's like, that works good.
Now I'm on the slide about unintentional prompts. And we talked about quite a few of these positioning of materials. Voice inflection, so I'm like, what's your mother's name? Right, if I'm trying to get them to discriminate between their mom's name and their dad's name, and my SD needs to be, what's your mother's name? To cue into that part of them asking, that's a prompt. I need to get rid of that before I count that skill.
Is that just to get them thinking?
You can't get them attention to the most, what's the word? The most salient part of the question is the word mother, right? The what and the name, that's not the most salient part, it's the word mom. So if I'm stressing that in the way I ask the question, that's cue. So that's when I say, what's your dad's name, that's what I'm trying to then I'm discriminating to you too. So I go, what's your mother's name? When I do that, they, oh yeah, okay, I got it right. But if I go, what's your mother's name? What's your, and I'm trying to do like fluency, where I can come back with lots of personal information questions, what's your mom name, dad's name, what's the name of your school, what's your teacher's name? And I can say all that kind of in the same inflection and tone, and they can still attend to the content of what my question is. That's what we're after. But if I have to kind of stress the most salient part of the question, that's a cue. Okay, and then facial expression. So that's another thing too. So I've got kiddos, I've got learners here at the school, and I put these cards out, say, and I have these cards out, and they kind of start reaching towards their right hands, kind of hovering over the right answer, and I go, ah! Yeah, I get ready to like just explode into my excitement into social praise, but haven't even done the right response yet. And like, oh, well, I'm sure I'm with that one now, Janice, because you just gave me all sorts of information that I wasn't right. And that's wrong with me. I need to wait till I get there with my breath. Because they're cueing from my facial expression. So that's a way that we can inadvertently cue responses to. Okay. And none of those things are necessarily bad. We're using those as strategies to keep, as long as we understand that those are prompts and we are working to get rid of them. And that counting a skill as learned when they're still in place. All right. We're going to play a game. We have half an hour, so we're close to the game. Prompting rules. So we need to prompt with the instruction or before the response. Reinforce behaviors that are independent more than you reinforce behaviors that are prompted. Right, that's that differential reinforcement, which I think I took out of the slide. And then you want to fade your prompts gradually. That gradually piece is important because you'll notice if you take them away too fast, then it always collapses on you. You have to go back and do lots more work. So I'm going to introduce shaping, and then we're going to play the shaping. Has anybody ever played the shaping game before at trainings or workshops? Okay, then I think you'll enjoy it. It's not a contest. It's not like two teams or anything.
Well,
yeah, some of you are surprised because I didn't like to do that. So, spoiler alert. Okay. They tolerate you real well over in that language program. Okay, so shaping. Shaping is a process of systematically reinforcing successive approximations to the end behavior. So you think about shaping, let's say you have a kid who's going to talk, and you want them to say, eat, but they don't have any language, they don't have any verbal vocalization. So you might start with reinforcing them to say, eat. No. You just said eat. Like they didn't, they just said it, but you give them the food. So eat gets the food. And you get that shaped up, it's consistently happening, they're saying eat. So now you're ready to shape the behavior or raise the bar or the criteria that earns reinforcement. I'm no longer going to give you the food when you just say eat. I'm going to have to actually hear eat, right? Maybe if I'm going to really drag it out. So they have to completely more approximate the final or the target response in order to get the reinforcer now. I've changed the rule. No longer does that beginning response of eat get you anything. I'm holding out for something better. And that's the shaping. So reinforcements withheld until you get closer and closer approximations to what you're looking for. And that might be true of a lot of all these age learners and different skills. So, you know, a kid who's writes their hand, writes their name, you might first reinforce the first time they just scrawl off all five letters on the paper. That is your name. Oh my gosh, you wrote your name. But what you really care about is I'm writing at the top of the page, on the line, with a capital letter. Right? But you're going to get there. But you're not going to wait until you get that end response of every letter in order, a line appearance, capital letter, before you deliver some rewards or some praise. That wouldn't be an effective way to teach. So you start by reinforcing this initial skill, and then you just start tightening it up. And you just withhold, the key piece in shaping is that you withhold reinforcement for those earlier, easier skills as you're raising it for the new one. So now I'm not going to reinforce you just writing dance on the page. And now it has to be at least on the top half quadrant. Or not quadrant, that'd be four. The top half of the paper, right? And so forth. So that's what I explained that to you. So now we're going to play this game to drive home the point of shaping. So how it works is I just need one volunteer who will step out of the room while we shape your behavior. We'll call you back in. So anyone willing to volunteer?
Go ahead.
Okay, Laura, would you mind?
No.
Okay. So just go so we can't hear us talking.
Okay.
And then we'll play back in just a minute.
Okay.
We'll be long hours.
Very good one.
Okay. So what we need to do is
stomach and sample. We can all look at her, but we can't. Okay? I got it? Alright, I'm gonna call her back in. Alright, Laura?
Yeah.
Okay, we're ready. Yeah, I'm not gonna talk to her. Anything I'm telling her today. Okay, so I didn't tell you how the game works. So when I clap, you get a percentage of money. Okay? So you get a lot of money and there's a beginning sum.
Okay. Got
okay.
It.
So I'm gonna teach you to do something. That you don't know what to do? Okay, so we'll end the room again. Okay. Want to enter the room? You don't have eyes on her. You just behave, okay? You have to do what? You have to behave. You're trying to get my money.
Okay.
Okay?
Sorry.
So you just be. Just so I'm gonna give you direction from my tapping. So right now I'm doing nothing, so that means you're not doing something right. So you have to try a bunch of stuff if you want to get my money. Just for fun. The only cue I can give you is a tap. I can't do anything else to cue you other than the tap.
Okay. Thank you.
2.5 minutes.
Wow. 2.5 minutes. About forever,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Lots of you and I, but it's 2.5 minutes. So that was it. All the information you have in the movie.
Yeah.
Here you go. So that's the thing that you do. It's a fun party game.
Yeah.
So thank you for playing and being a good sport.
It's very deep.
Because you got a lot of reinforcement for response to five for making the right response. I'm a little out of practice being the leader on that game.
Somebody else go.
Alright, so I've got just, I think, one more slide, and then we can ask questions, we can take time to do our test and we'll go through examples, and I have a data. Oh, so your slide's different than mine. So differential reinforcement, this is the shaping game, right? So, sorry. I wasn't sure how long it was going to take.
Right? I know.
I thought, oh my goodness, it'll go a long time. Good thing I started early, because sometimes, you know, people come in and they'll start touching everything, and they're like, you know,
but
you weren't doing a lot of behavior, so the less behavior that you engaged in, it took longer. But 2.5 minutes was not very long. You know, come in the room, touch that.
But you kept looking at her too and trying to get facial expressions.
Yeah, you were looking at me.
Yeah. You wanted something from me other than the clamping. So the term differential reinforcement just refers to reinforcing different responses differently. So difficult tasks get more reinforcement than easier tasks. We must be really mindful that we are moving towards more natural schedules of reinforcement, which is occasionally, and more natural types of reinforcement, which are social. So questions about that at all?
We have multiple slides on
here. Okay, let's go.
No.
I didn't update my, so I said this already. What's the next one? So, differential reinforcement, again, if you're going to reinforce some responses and other ones don't get reinforced. So you saw where there was no reinforcement, there was some reinforcement, there was a lot of reinforcement. This example of differential reinforcement. So now it's a slide that I was prepared for, which is kind of the last slide, which is how to make learning, tonight's subject is about learning and teaching, so how can you make teaching or learning fun? Because that's the most successful learner is going to enjoy learning and come back to the teacher, come back for more. So being enthusiastic, not so much in your demand delivery for our older learners, but more in our praise. Get excited, be fun to be around. The setting is important because what happens is kids start associating or pairing a certain desk or room or table at the house with homework or demands, and they don't want to come to that space anymore. So you want to vary, the one rationale for varying the setting of demands is I don't always think, I can come to this table and think that it could be a fun time. It doesn't always mean I have to do my homework here. We can play board games here and so forth. Another reason to vary your setting when you're teaching is for generalization purposes. You know, so you might have a learner who is really good at telling, in the presence of a familiar person at the kitchen table, when asked, you know, hey, what's your mom's name? They can tell you. But if they're at a shopping mall parking lot, or they're in a, you know, hotel lobby and they're lost or separated from their parents, and a uniformed officer says, hey, what's your mom's name? And, you know, I need to get a hold of your parents. They can't do that. So that example I just gave is actually generalization across many different things, right? Generalization across who's asking, generalization across setting, probably generalization across who's asking. But the point is, in this example, is vary your setting. But when you're teaching, you really do care about generalizing across all those different domains. Because a skill that a student can only do when one person asks a certain way, at a certain place, on a certain time of day, whatever, that's not a very valuable skill to have, is it? So varied instruction is similar. If we only teach, what's your mom's name, and then someone else says, you know, hey, what's your mama's name? Or what do you call your mom? Or what's your mom's last name? Any way you can kind of mix up the way of asking, and they only know to respond to that one way they've been taught, that's not valuable either. Or say using the toilet. You have kids who don't generalize that so well to public stall. say, or a urinal versus a closed stall or so forth. So that generalization piece is really important. Materials, keep materials interesting. So, you know, if you've got a student who you know loves SpongeBob or superheroes, if you can incorporate those materials into your teaching, oftentimes it can be helpful. Sometimes it can be distracting, so it is kind of learner specific. But when you can be a good strategy, because then they're like, oh, I want to hang out with you and do that stuff, even though I didn't realize it was number ID, you know, or color or whatever. Move on when the skill is mastered. Sometimes this is something that we're guilty of, because it's being a tech course, the kid is so bored. Why do you keep asking me my phone number, you know, or whatever? I'm ready for the next thing. And so we do try to, when we teach, is have a ratio of learned skills to unlearned skills. So let's say math homework or any subject, you would want a math worksheet. You want to have a lot of problems on that math worksheet be relatively easy or learned, and then you put in, you intersperse the harder ones, and then you get them on a roll responding right, and then they're more inclined to tackle that harder one. So don't be a dead horse. If a skill is learned, count it as learned, put it into what we call our maintenance pile or maintenance group of skills that we use to keep our sessions fast and interesting and keep our reinforcement going. And then we pepper in at about 20% skills they don't know yet that they're still trying to learn. And that helps us maintain that high success rate. Interspersed tasks. So in our program, we have skills in several different domains, right? So we might be teaching a student to identify their coins. We might be doing some environmental print signs. We might be doing some, you know, how to do a laundry load. And so it gets really boring for a kid if you just sit there and all you're drilling is, you know, number ID, say, or coin identification or money math. And then you finish that and you go over to this next subset of skills. We don't do it that way. We try to, like, do a hodgepodge and throw it all in together in what's called interspersal. So they don't really know what's coming next. So maybe some skills that I might be drilling or teaching are preferred or are easier, and they're all kind of mixed in together. And then this is a good one to end on. Don't punish a learner or a student with great behavior by just keeping it going. And we all do this, right?
Oh my gosh, the session went an hour and a half. They didn't mind at all. There was no question. And they just kept working for it in 90 minutes. Like, wow, you know, that poor guy.
Yeah.
You know, what a reward he got for being well behaved. You know, where the next time he comes and he throws a fit, and that was 20 minutes. You know, that session was a lot shorter.
So we need to be a little more mindful of this. I do too. Because we also get so excited that things are going well, so we're more inclined to keep going. But it ended up could be a little punishing for the student who's well behaved. So it's better to say, well, you're doing so great. Let's cut this session short today. And that's time they show up for a session to do some learning or do homework or whatever. But last time, this ended early when I was good, so who knows what's going to happen this time. So that concludes my prepared slides. So I'm willing to entertain questions or scenarios if you have them. And if you don't, then I have a post-test and an evaluation.